Hello YouTube, ClydeSight here with another adventure in vintage tape recorders. And this time we have a bit of a mystery. Here you see two tape recorders. Both tape recorders are made by Wollensak 3M. We can see that on the handle. This is a 5-inch reel-to-reel tape recorder. So what happened? Did I buy two of these units? This is the Wollensak model 3500 5-inch reel-to-reel tape recorder. Don't have the reels in it right now, but we've seen this before on ClydeSight channel. And this is a new unit for ClydeSight channel. It is a completely different machine, and I'm going to reveal the mystery now. This is the model 4310, also produced or sold by Wollensak 3M. Now, it's obvious that the two units were meant to be companions. And according to Phantom Productions, which archives a lot of information about these old vintage tape recorders, this is considered a very rare unit. This is a cassette unit, and it was made by Sanyo, or so it would seem. And we're going to look inside the machine and find out why I am claiming this is made by Sanyo. Now, if you like a good mystery, besides looking at tape recorders, please take a look at Amazon Kindle. I have a mystery book up there under the name Garnell Thompson is the author, because I co-authored it with Catherine Garnell of the United Kingdom, and it is called The Cross of Ramplett, The Mystery of Throckmorton Manor.
My name is Darla Throckmorton, and I am the most conniving and scheming bitch this side of the English Channel. If you want to stay on my good side, you'd better read my book, The Cross of Ramplett.
To be quite honest, that mystery is a little bit easier to understand than what's going on here, as we'll find out. Let's take a quick tour of the machine. We have a volume control, we have a tone control, we have a meter, it has a switch for an automatic level control or manual control. It has a record switch here, and it has an eject button here, which snaps open the door. The door does not carry the cassette. You have to put the cassette in the well to lock it down. We have stop, rewind, forward, play, and pause. Forward means fast forward, obviously. All of these buttons do not lock down except for the play button. So I can lock the play button down, but rewind, nope, forward, nope, and pause, no, will not lock down. We also have a 3-digit tape counter. Let's take a look at the side. On the side of the machine, we have our inputs for external speaker, auxiliary, microphone, remote for the microphone, and then a foot switch control. Now, both the remote and the foot switch control do the same thing. We also have here a speaker monitor switch off and on, and this will work as a PA system. In the back here, we have provision for AC power and a switch, so when we're on AC power, we put it one way. If we're on battery power, we put it the other way. It takes a special cord. This is the closest thing I could find to it. It's a radio phono cord from the 1960s that will fit on these pins. The pins are not standard size compared to the pins in other portable tape recorders of the time period. Underneath there was a badge here that's gone, and this is the battery compartment. And it takes 5 D-size batteries in this compartment. Now, this machine is extremely heavy for a cassette recorder. So this was obviously not designed to be a portable unit. It was probably meant to be used in schools and offices for dictation or music instruction or language instruction. With this huge size that it has, you would think that this is a really fabulous machine. It certainly looks like it, but bigger is not necessarily better. I'm going to compare this Wollensak cassette tape recorder to a Bell & Howell tape recorder that was very, very popular at the same time. Both these units appear to have been made by Sanyo. We see the word Japan on the parts of the machine all over the place, and it's obvious that Wollensak did not make this in the United States. Now, we get a very easy clue if we look at the motor. There's a label on the motor here that says Sanyo. And we can see by looking at the capacitors on the amplifier board, they're also labeled Sanyo. However, when we look at the speaker, we do not see the Sanyo name, we simply see Japan. But it is probably safe to assume that the speaker also came from Sanyo. Another clue that we have that this is a Sanyo-designed machine, or built machine, is the actual drive system itself. And the best way to understand that is to look at certain characteristics that we see in Sanyo machines. One of the things that we see is there is always an idler that rubs against the capstan flywheel, and that manages the fast-forward and the take-up. This is characteristic of Sanyo. There's no belt going to any other part of the machine. Now, here we have a Bell & Howell machine. Very similar characteristics. For one thing, we have our take-up clutch here and our take-up clutch here. We have the idler that drives the rewind and fast forward. We have the idler that drives the rewind and fast forward. We have a similar transport mechanism here and here. And of course, the motor is located back here and here. Now, this mechanism is identical to the mechanism used in the Lloyd's 8V84A. So this would indicate that Sanyo probably was the builder of the Wollensak machine. But we also see that there have been some significant changes made. The clutch mechanism has a plastic rotating piece here that's run by the belt. The motor belt wraps around it, and it presses against this plate. Now, this plate is covered with a piece of felt, and so this creates the clutch mechanism. The way it gets pressure is that underneath the plate, which we can't see here, there's a spring, and that spring presses against the plate. The plate here also is affixed to this shaft. That shaft goes through the entire mechanism to the other side, where it runs the spindle that presses against the take-up table, and that's how it does take-up during playback and record. But you could not change this because the clutch plate is fixed here and it's fixed on the other side to the spindle, so you could not take this mechanism apart. Now, here we see a similar construction, but it has some very significant differences. First of all, the clutch plate is now underneath this plastic rotating pulley. Again, you see the belt going around it, and the spring is located here with the collar here and an E-clip. So you could take the E-clip out, stretch the spring or replace it, and strengthen the clutch between the plate and the other part of the clutch plate mechanism. And I believe that they did this in order to improve the catching capability of the take-up table and prevent the problems that were caused by the thing failing and the machine feeding tape into the capstan and pinch roller. This is the idler that presses against the capstan flywheel and manages the fast forward and the rewind. It's a brass piece with a tire molded onto it. So this tire can never be replaced because it's part of this piece. When the machine is in stop, this is being held against the capstan flywheel by the spring pressure of the mechanism. It only disengages from the capstan flywheel when the machine is in play or record. Let's take a look at the Bell & Howell and see if that's any different. The wheel is pressing against the capstan flywheel in the stop position, so it will develop flats over time just as it will in the Wollensak. But there is a difference here in that this is a plastic hub with a tire that sits in a groove. You could take that tire out and replace it. In fact, a plumber's O-ring will replace this very nicely. The rewind table is mounted to this plate, which mounts to the deck. And the reason they did that is the rewind table is down here, and there's a pulley here, and the two of them engage with a locking mechanism, and this pulley runs this belt, and that belt runs another pulley, which is attached to the three-digit counter. Now notice how long this pulley is. It's made of brass. But what we want to do is look at how this mechanism and this mechanism compare, because there are some similarities and there are some differences, and that helps us understand the mystery of the Wollensak. So first we're going to take a look at the bell and howl. Now what we see happening here is very simple. Remember the idler wheel that had the tire on it that we looked at on the other side of the machine? Well, this is the other end of it, and it is a simple metal idler, and that idler in rewind will press against this idler, which presses against the feed table. So when we put it into rewind, you see how it shifted. I don't have power to the machine, but you see how that shifts. And then if I turn this, you see how it's trying to spin. Now in fast forward, it's just simply going to go over and press against the take-up table. And just like the Lloyd's 8V84A, this is a non-locking fast forward, so you have to hold it down. But you see how it's moving there. So you have metal to rubber here, and then you have metal to rubber here and rubber to rubber here in rewind. Now I have power to the Wollensak machine, so we can see how it works in rewind, but notice that instead of having just a metal idler here, we have a brass piece that has a tire permanently affixed to it so you can't replace it. Now that rubber presses against this plastic idler here, which then presses against the rewind table. And there we see it in rewind. And you may be hearing some thumping. And that thumping is caused by this idler. The other side of this idler that we looked at before has a flap because it was pressing against the capstan flywheel for all those years. And then in fast forward, this is going to go against the take-up table. And again, you can hear the thumping. It's unavoidable. So that's the difference that between the two machines. And you notice this whole mechanism is underneath here, and the reason is, again, because they're trying to feed the belt underneath this table over to the three-digit tape counter. And if we move over here, we can see the idler for the playback or record. Now, the Wollensak does have a pause control, and when I press the pause control key down, it simply moves the idler away as well as the pinch roller. You see how the pinch roller is pulling off the capstan and the idler is moving away. This is a non-locking pause control. Moving to the left of the drive mechanism, we can see the amplifier board. And Wollensak in this particular machine did something very unusual, or Sanyo, who built the machine, however it got made, they made the amplifier board accessible so it could easily be repaired. Here we can see all of the components here, and it's very typical of a cassette recorder. There are about 14 electrolytic capacitors in here, plus about 8 transistors, and there is the AC bias coil here. And right on the top of the amplifier board is the record play switch, so it's very easy to get to clean. Now that's controlled by this knob here. So when I trip the mechanism to allow it to move, watch this switch. At the same time, there is a very small catch piece here, which is just right at the edge of the screen. Watch that move if you can. And that catch piece, locks the switch in the record position when the play button is pushed. these components are mounted on this strange piece of semi-clear plastic. Now, the space here that seems to be for just being wasted is actually where the magnet goes for the speaker. Here is the underside of the amplifier board, completely accessible so that if components have to be desoldered and resoldered, easy to do. We see also the battery terminals here. There's a plastic well that sits on top of this, and that is what holds the batteries. And do you see these two wires here that I'm working? Those are clamp-on wires for the speaker, which makes it nice because you can get the whole thing out of the case and it's not all dangling around. One thing that is unusual is that there is this little extra board that they mounted here, and I don't have the service manual, so I don't know what that board is for or why it is separated. It may have to do with the automatic level control. This cassette recorder is very rich in mystery, and here is this extremely heavy front end. Why they made it so heavy, I don't know, but we have another mystery here. Because although this matches the 5-inch reel-to-reel Wollensak, let's take a look at the underside of this and we'll see they may have had some other plans. Now if we look at the underside of it, we see that it's a very different shape altogether, and there's this big slot here which looks to me like it was a slot for a radio dial. Remember the logarithmic radio dials where the indicator moved back and forth along a long track? And there's some holes here for controls or switches, but none of this is functional or visible from the other side of the unit. So they may have at one time or other designed this as a radio cassette recorder, and then for some reason decided to scrap those plans and just made it into a regular tape recorder. I can't see any reason why they would have this here otherwise. To record on the Wollensak tape recorder, I've plugged in a replacement Radio Shack microphone, and it's got the remote switch, so we hold the record button down, push play. Testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is a test of the Wollensak. This is a test of the Wollensak using the automatic level control. The automatic level control. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. She sells seashells by the seashore. She sells seashells by the seashore. Now it's making a blank recording because I want to find out how much noise the amplifier is putting on the cassette itself just using the tape through it. I now have the Bell & Howell tape recorder set up to make a recording. It also has an automatic level control. Testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Testing the solid-state cassette recorder made by Bell & Howell. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. She sells seashells by the seashore. And again, I've unplugged the microphone to hear any noise in recording that the machine is going to put on the tape. So we'll let it go for a second, and then we will press stop. And now I'm going to put the tape back in the Wollensak, rewind it, and we're going to hear both recordings, then we'll do it again on the Bell & Howell. Be prepared for a surprise. So the tape is rewound and loaded in the machine. Here we go. Testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is a test of the Wollensak. This is a test of the Wollensak using the automatic level control. The automatic level control. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. She sells seashells by the seashore. She sells seashells by the seashore. Notice the tape hiss.
Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Testing the solid-state cassette recorder made by Bell and Howell. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. She sells seashells by the seashore.
Notice the tape hiss on this. Now let's hear it play back through the Bell and Howell.
Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is a test of the Wollensak. This is a test of the Wollensak using the automatic level control. The automatic level control. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. She sells seashells by the seashore. She sells seashells by the seashore.
Again, we're hearing quite a bit of hiss.
Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Testing the solid-state cassette recorder made by Bell and Howell. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. She sells seashells by the seashore.
So, what have we learned? Well, it is a mystery what Wollensak was doing, but it does prove something. Size does not matter. It's what's inside that counts.
Thank you for watching this video about the Wollensak 4310 cassette tape recorder from the late 1960s. The mystery machine. And the mystery is now solved. We don't know what they were doing. And for more fun mystery, go to Amazon.com and look up The Cross of Ramplett, The Mystery of Throckmorton Manor by Garnell Thompson. It's a wonderful book that you can get from Amazon.com for your Kindle, and you can also get it at Barnes & Noble if you have a Nook reader. So don't forget The Cross of Ramplett, The Mystery of Throckmorton Manor. It makes more sense than what Wollensak and Sanyo were doing in the 1960s. Thanks for watching the video. Please continue to watch ClydeSight channel for more vintage tape recorder videos. Bye-bye, YouTube.